This week at the Internet Cafe, travel on the net. If you want to do more than just visit tourist spots, check out earthwatch.org, where you can find out about trips that can help save the planet. This guy spends 7 hours a day on the web looking for great sites for the Net magazine's Blue Pages. He'll tell us about his favorite online travel sites. The Lonely Planet books have been valued travelers' guides for years. Now the Lonely Planet folks are running a great website to help you plan your next trip. And Mike Wilkins travels the country in search of weird stuff, and he finds it. You can find out about it on his website called Roadside America. Plus, free software, 3 great travel games for kids, and a 48-language phrasebook called The Travel Tutor. All coming up on our Cyber Blast, traveling on the web, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet here with Jane Wither, Andrew deVries. We're at CyberSmith in Palo Alto, California, talking about travel on the net. And Jane, you've done a lot of this. How do you use the net for travel?
Oh, I think it's great. I mean, you can pretty much plan out your whole trip. If you're going to a faraway place, you can actually check out the sites and prioritize your time. And the best part is you can actually even check out the hotel rooms before you book it.
You booked your honeymoon on the net, didn't you?
My husband did.
All right.
And it was awesome. It was great.
Well, what was so good about it?
Well, I mean, just the fact that you could see the room. And
you actually looked at what the room in the hotel looked like.
Yeah. Knew if it was clean.
Enough said, and I'm not telling you anymore.
Your turn, Andrew. You do the stuff?
I haven't done a lot of it, but recently I went to Iceland, my big Iceland trip.
Okay.
Here
we go again.
All right. And it's a pretty isolated country. There's not a lot of great tour books, travel guides about Iceland. And I was able to go up on the web and find all kinds of information on the culture, the language, the monetary system, where to get the best sweater for my girlfriend. I mean, it was all there. So that was really helpful.
Well, I do like it a lot just for booking airplane tickets. I've been doing this for like 10, 12 years. You save money. You get right into the big computer system. You don't have to worry about, is the travel agent really doing the best job for you? Was there really a cheaper fare? I have many times gotten the best fare and the best deal by doing it myself after talking to an airline or talking to a travel agent. I like it for that.
Yeah. I think one of the neat things is that when you really want to find some unusual sites, it's the best place to find
it. More unusual than Iceland?
Even more unusual.
Well, alternative kinds of adventure, traveling,
exactly.
And that kind of stuff. It's really terrific.
Things
for
that you wouldn't know that were.
And we're going to have some pretty good examples. All right, travel on the net this week at the Internet Cafe.
So now tonight we're doing a show about travel via the Internet. And I think one of the most compelling sites that we went to was the Earthwatch site. And I just, the list of activities were endless. But maybe, Linda, you can tell us a little bit about what Earthwatch is all about.
Earthwatch is the third largest private source of research funds for scientists who do field research, archaeologists, marine biologists, botanists, the kind of people who need to get out in the field and get their work done. And we fund their research in a very unique way. We enable volunteers to join them on their projects. So the volunteer actually makes a contribution to the research. It's often in the neighborhood of $1,500 for 2 weeks. They go and they become a working part of an expedition. So it's sort of like National Geographic and you are in it.
You're actually live. So the money that you would spend is actually going towards your travel costs and just participating in the expedition?
The money that you spend goes, half of it goes to actually underwrite the research. So you are going as a funder of research. But you yourself also go and participate. So if you love archaeology, you might make a contribution to uncover a Mayan tomb in Belize, and you actually join the project in Belize, become a working
partner. It sounds like there might be a bit of a tax benefit, too, on participating in something like that.
Ah, you guessed it. Earthwatch is a nonprofit, and so the airfare, whatever it costs you to get to the research site, wherever that be in the world, and we have 130 sites, is actually tax deductible, and the share of costs that what you pay to join the expedition is tax deductible also.
That makes it even more appealing. So
well, it
that,
does.
That's
it's
interesting.
It's a wonderful way to travel and make a difference and take a tax deduction.
Now, Claire, I know that you do work with a lot of people who are interested in becoming volunteers,
uh-huh.
And both of you actually been on a number of expeditions. What would be one expedition that you think was the most interesting for you?
Well, I enjoyed the Mountain Lion Project in southern Idaho. We were doing radio telemetry, tracking the mountain lions, and the study was about habitat and how much habitat they need and preserve their genetic stability. I've been on 10, so
wow.
I can't think. I've done art of building in Mexico, and last year I was studying birds, the migratory birds. I was in Hungary.
So you've had quite an experience. And
right,
I guess now the volunteers come from all over the world, too. These are not just
U.S.-based.
So, I mean, you're getting exposed to multiple cultures, not only by traveling, but also by working with the people on the expeditions. Now, what are some other projects that are upcoming in 97 that people might be interested in?
There are some wonderful projects with animals in Africa, particularly big animals like elephants and predatory animals like cheetah. There are some wonderful projects in archaeology and art. There's a wonderful project in Venice that has to do with actually preserving Venetian art with scientists who are at work trying to keep the water at bay and the bad air at bay and everything else. With 130 projects, I must say it's difficult to choose one. That's where the website is such a brilliant tool for us, because it does enable people to look at the entire magazine. And we do put out a magazine, but the web is our...
Oh, it was incredibly compelling. I think the images were great. And what was interesting for me was the commentary of all of the people who participated in these activities, the volunteers, and they had their own stories to tell about the expeditions and how it impacted them. And I hazard a guess that you get a lot of multiple people coming back for multiple trips. And once they've gone on one, they get hooked.
There are people who tell us they'll never travel any other way again, that they really, it's fun to travel with a purpose and feel you've made a difference. And certainly in the case of this research, it wouldn't happen without a volunteer's contribution. And research funds are drying up, so it is becoming more and more a matter of life and death for some of these researchers to really rely on volunteers.
Thanks very much for coming. This was great stuff.
Thanks.
Jennifer and Eric, you guys are from The Lonely Planet, which I think is one of the definitive and kind of a fun guide to traveling. You've really come up with, you know, sort of out-of-the-way spots, out-of-the-way places, Cuba, Antarctica, Southeast Asia. It's not your usual vacation spots. How did you guys start with this whole Lonely Planet series?
Well, it started innocently enough as a honeymoon by Lonely Planet founders Tony and Maureen Wheeler, who went across Asia on what was known as the Hippie Trail.
How long was that honeymoon?
Well, it was supposed to be a few months, and it turned into about 25 years.
Oh, wow. So the honeymoon isn't over, I see. And so they have, from that trip, basically started writing and got other writers together?
Exactly. They arrived in Australia flat broke, but with all these great ideas about the trip. And a lot of travelers came up to them and asked questions about where they stayed, how did they get from this place to that place, and they thought, hey, this is a great idea for a travel guidebook.
Which I think is what seems like really sets these travel guides apart, is that they are, you know, written by real writers, real people that have been to these fun, out-of-the-way places. Now you guys have this website up, and from what I've seen on there, it looks like there's other real stories, real travelers going on there. What's on the website that... it sort of links up to The Lonely Planet?
Well, I think the great thing that we have on our website is relevant information for travelers, written by travelers. Good perishable information.
Perishable, what do you mean by that?
Well, I mean information that's so new it's not rotting like an old tomato. And that's important when you're traveling independently, the way Lonely Planet encourages.
Okay, I saw a section on there called The Thorn Tree, which I don't know what that's really based on, but it seemed like a place where people can post information about trips in real time.
Well, the Thorn Tree is a really remarkable aspect of our website, because it allows people to hook up with each other and leave messages and recommendations for places they've been, places they want to go, and even say, hey, I'm going to be traveling to Latin America in a few months, who wants to travel with me? And they can hook up and give advice. And it's very much like the beginning of Lonely Planet books with Tony and Maureen, when they're offering advice. I mean, it's very much like a friend whispering in your ear and saying, you've got to do this.
Right, and reading through some of that stuff, I saw there was some pretty kind of far out stuff going on there. I mean, some of the, like, the safety and health you know, things that were going on in different countries, to I saw this awesome beach somewhere that, you know, you just need to go check it out. So
yeah, I think the health section is an important trip planning tool. You know, we don't go into great detail on what you need, precautions you need to take, but we do give solid, well-tested advice about health before you leave on virtually any place in the world.
And we always provide resources so that you can go further and find out. If we don't have the information, here's a place you can go to find the information. And that's really what the web is all about.
Right.
Finding information and finding out how to get to the information
right.
you need.
I saw also more information in the form of pictures. It looks like there's photo essays up there. Where do you get those from?
Well, most of those come from the travel writers who provide it while they're researching the guidebooks on the road.
Really? Now, one I have to ask you about is Cuba.
Yeah.
That is not some place that most Americans get to go.
Well, interestingly, this one was published by Lonely Planet US, and they're threatening us with $55,000 fines in going to Cuba, but it's an exciting destination, and I kind of think it's un-American not to allow Americans to go visit it.
Right. And so you can find some information about this as well up there. What do you see as sort of the future with website versus a hardcover, a book that you need to look at? How do they link up for future stuff?
Well, I think what we're working towards is the continuously updated travel guidebook, where we provide updates of current editions of Lonely Planet guidebooks that can then be freely downloaded by travelers who've bought them.
So you buy this, and then you basically get to get updates when you can and keep the current information
exactly.
non-perishable,
yeah.
as you said.
Exactly.
That's great. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Hi, interested in special interest travel? Come visit us at www.infohub.com, where you can query special interest tours. Interested in food? You can join us in the gastronomy tours in France. Like cycling, you can join the bicycle tours that goes through Italy. Or if you're a collector and like to collect toys and antiques, you can join the collector's tours in Germany. In addition, you can find a wealth of travel information that's available all over the world that would help you learn more about the destination of these special interest travel tours. Remember, it's InfoHub.
All right, Mike, you've written this book, The Roadside America. Actually, it's the new version of Roadside America. You've got a website that does the same thing. Actually, you and two of your buddies.
Right.
How do you find this stuff? I mean, this is a collection, both in the book and the website, of the weirdest tourist attractions I've ever heard of. I mean, do you just spend all your time running around just trying to find nutty stuff?
Well, Ken and Doug and I are out on the road probably 9 months out of the year looking for this stuff. Because you have to get out and visit. You can't write the Chambers of Commerce. A lot of times
not the kind of stuff you're writing about.
No, a lot of times there'll be a statue of a giant peanut out front of the courthouse, and you call and say, what's in your town? They'll go, well, I don't know.
Just to them, it's nothing.
Right. When you get there, there's a big peanut
in it. Oh, my God, what a ridiculous thing.
Yeah. Oh, that peanut? You wanted to know about the peanut? Oh, yeah.
What are other examples of stuff you guys have found that were really weird and interesting that are worth going in the book or going on your website?
Well, for example, once we were looking for the world's largest badger up in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
It's a big statue over top of a gas station. And we stumbled into this town of Annawa, and there's a guy named Wilbert Bain there, who's a 75-year-old self-taught lion tamer. And so he lives in a farm, but out back, there's a cage and a setup and lions and tigers.
Yeah, whips and chairs.
Whips and chairs. Yeah. He has a little beat-up cassette recorder that plays the theme from SWAT.
And he charges people to watch him do the lion bit.
Yeah, and he's trained them himself.
He That's definitely never worth took going
lesson.
To.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, other things, I mean, you talk about, like, the largest peanut. I mean, just, you have to find a lot of stupid stuff every now and then before you find something really cool that's worth going to.
A lot of times you run into the world's second largest peanut. And, in fact, there are five towns that claim to have the world's largest peanut. And of course, only one wins, Ashburn, Georgia. So that's a disappointment. Someone says, hey, we've got the world's largest peanut, you go.
I guess it's nice now that you have a website. People can leave you information. It's not just you three guys running around. But if I find something weird, I can go in there, and that becomes part of your Roadside America website. Are you getting a lot of good stuff?
Yeah, we actually are, and we're very encouraged by it. We've got a community, a tongue-in-cheek community called the Smileage Club. And one of the things that our smilers do is send us attractions and send us, hey, what about this? Or, hey, you know, didn't you see this?
Yeah.
And that's a list of
what's some of the good ones you got from people other than you and your partners?
Well, a guy whose grandfather lived in Philippi, West Virginia,
yeah.
was the man who had his leg amputated first in the Civil War. There's a little marker in Philippi, West Virginia, about that. And that's something that, you know, they're not going to put up.
Is there a postcard there you're going to picture this poor guy? Now, let me ask you. You actually work with some cities. I mean, you guys are, like, really mischievous at this. You say, hey, here's a city, a little town. Nobody ever comes and visits it. Why don't you guys do something weird? We'll put it in the book. People come visit.
Right, because there are towns in this country that need tourism. The basic industry is down and people are leaving.
Yeah.
They want tourists to come.
So what do you tell them?
Well, we just say, have a little imagination. Take that leap.
Like,
for example, one of the things we're pitching is the Hair of All Nations display.
The Hair of All Nations display.
Imagine the city park.
Yeah.
Giant plexiglass ball, 15 feet high. Everyone that visits cuts off a lock of their hair, throws it in the hair of all nations. When you get home, you're going to tell your friends, hey, next time you're traveling through Kansas, stop there.
You've got to say this is the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
Yeah, and cut off a lock of your hair and throw it in. It creates a community.
There's a difference, isn't there, between stuff that really naturally grows out of a town and just totally artificial stuff that you put together?
Yeah, there are. I mean, there are towns that are known for their industry, you know, the earmuff capital of the world and the red flannel town and so on.
So there'll be some reality to it.
Yeah.
Now, this seems like a uniquely American thing. I mean, the biggest peanut and all this sort of strange stuff. Is it? I mean, is this really something you write about in this country only?
Well, you get isolated examples around the world. For example, the ancient Egyptians had trained crocodiles for the Romans. But there's so much history in Europe.
You don't need the hairballs if you're in Europe, but you got churches and stuff.
That's right. You can't demolish a church and put up a mini golf. They just won't let you.
Your website is just, I mean, there's no commercials, there's no ads, it's just sort of fun.
Yeah.
I mean, is that the idea, just sort of keep on playing?
Well, we wanted to do it. We wanted to have a big, deep site, you know, so there are like 300 pages in there.
Right.
We don't want any ads right now. We just want this big ball floating there that's pretty
self-contained. A tourist attraction of its own.
Yeah, that you can go, it's pretty self-contained, you can navigate any way you want.
It's really cool.
Thank you.
Mike, thanks a lot.
All right.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you 5 programs that have to do with travel, sort of. We'll feed you 3 games and 2 utilities. 5 files altogether, more than 4 megabytes of data in less than 120 seconds. You can actually see the data downloading to your PC right now over here. Now, to get these files this fast through your television set, you need an add-on card for your computer called a TV modem. More about that later. You can also download these files through our website using your regular telephone modem, which will take about half an hour. Let me tell you what we're sending you right now. First of all, a terrific little program called the Travel Tutor. This is a very handy foreign language translation program that gives you key tourist phrases in 48 different languages. No need to worry that you won't know how to say, "Where's the bathroom?" in Bulgarian. Next, the award-winning Magic School Bus that lets you do time travel. You can go backwards or forward through time and then get out of the bus to explore. We're also sending you Billy Bear's Summer Vacation. This is a very nice program for children with storybook animation that lets you explore the trails and lakes of Michigan. The third game we're downloading to you is Where's Waldo Exploring Geography? This is a demo of the full game in which you have to find Waldo, but in the process, you travel around the globe. Finally, a really wacky little program called Odometer that measures how far your mouse travels each day. You may be surprised to see the mileage your cursor racks up each month. It could literally be miles. Now, if you need information on how to retrieve a Cyber Blast or how to buy or install a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at www.pctv.com. You'll also find information there on how to download these files directly from the net. So, well, looks like the download is just about complete, so go have fun with your new software. That wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Giles Bateman.
This stuff is great, Pat. So, you know, as senior editor of the Net magazine, one of the things that you do a lot, and I mean a lot, is check out websites and give ratings. And tonight we're talking about travel, so I'd like to hear it from the expert. Let's hear some websites that you think are great for the well-seasoned traveler.
One of the ones I think is best is thetrip.com, which is aimed at business travelers primarily, but anyone who's in a rush, who hasn't figured out all the logistics of their trip, should probably go there first. You can do everything from book your flight to book your hotel room, figure out how you're going to get from the airport to your cousin's house, or wherever you're going. You can get detailed maps of the airport, see what businesses are located in what part of the airport. It'll do just about everything for you. So if you haven't done any planning yet, that's the place to go.
Now, one of the neat things about that particular website was that, for example, if I get stuck in an airport because of bad weather, I could actually find out...
You can find out other connecting flights. If you're worried about not making your connection, you can see where that flight is, and it'll tell you in the air exactly where that flight is.
And like it was updated within 3 minutes, I think, the one we checked out, which was kind of neat. Yeah. What about some other websites that for the traveler?
Well, along those same lines, a good site is MapQuest, which will draw up very sophisticated, exact maps. And one section of that site called TripQuest will allow you to put in a starting destination or a starting point and a destination and if you have the addresses, it'll tell you exactly how many miles you need to take a left turn, at how many miles you need to take a right turn, and it gets you right there and draws up a very detailed map for you.
So it's pretty accurate.
Yeah.
Now, what about eating on the road? I know that's a big one for me. I always like to check out the good restaurants.
Yeah, lots of sites out there having to do with food. And especially, it seems diner culture has caught on. There's a couple of sites, eathere.com, where people list their favorites. Talk about where you can go get the best burger in Atlanta or whatnot, and kind of pump their favorite greasy spoon on the site.
Any great recipes for really good spicy chili?
I saw a pretty good one for, what was it, buttermilk fried chicken. Sounded pretty good.
Must be from
you're
the South,
vegetarian,
right? Yeah,
so
I don't think I'd go for that one. Now, what about some for the offbeat traveler, somebody who doesn't necessarily like to do the Holiday Inn scene?
There's a few that I really like. One in particular, I think these guys are up in the North Woods somewhere, up in Michigan, I think. It's called Out Your Back Door. Started as a paper zine, now it's online. And they do everything from make their own ski wax to carve their own longbows. There's a bit of a travel element to it as well, but it seems to be like they go out their back door, that's how they get the title, jump on the bike, and wherever they go that day, they write about it later on, and you can go and see what kind of adventures they found.
So it's pretty interesting when you think about it with the internet. Now you can pretty much take it from one end of the travel experience to the other and cover the whole gambit.
Exactly. You've got your well-heeled travelers on one end, and then you've got your guys living in a trailer home in the North Woods somewhere.
Great stuff.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
You bet.
Hi, it's Eric at the Green Tortoise. You know, the famous bus company with the sleeper coaches. You might have heard of us. We've got beautiful buses, and we go to beautiful places. We travel all night and stop and play all day. We go as far south as Costa Rica, as far north as Alaska, in the summer, of course. We go cross-country. For more information, just look us up, www.greentortoise.com. Thank you.
You probably don't have an internet connection in your car, but still there is a really cool piece of technology you can use to plan your trip on the highways. To show you this, we have to get out of CyberSmith, so let me show you what I did this afternoon.
I'm driving this Hertz rental car, which comes with something called Neverlost, which is really a computer. It's a GPS-based computer that is reading satellites up in the sky so that it knows exactly where the car is within a block at any particular second. It also has a database in it of all the street addresses in California. So what I do is enter here the address that I'm going to.
Freeway entrance ahead on the left.
Which I just did before, so it's already telling me make a left at this freeway entrance. It knows where I am. I've told it where it is I want to go. It has automatically calculated how to get there. Now, I'm trying to find a bookstore in town here. I really don't know where it is, and I'm just going to follow its instructions. It said make a left onto this freeway, and that's what we'll do. Now, as you can see over here, this is really cool. This little triangle here is my car, and you can actually see the car. It's actually lost for a second. Now it's back on the freeway. That's my progress, second by second, as I'm moving on. Now, that's telling me what I should be doing next, so I'll go back to the overhead satellite map view. This thing is perfect for me because I am one of those guys who doesn't tend to want to ask for directions. I want to figure it out myself. Well, this really solves my problem because I don't have to ask for directions, and I can still find the place without getting into an argument with anyone.
Right turn ahead.
So it's telling me to go right when I get off the freeway here. And then it told me to make an immediate right after that. So let's see if it gets me to the right place. I'm trying to find this bookstore to go find a book on the internet, actually. And here it is.
That's a great show.
All right, Jane, so you booked your honeymoon on the web. Now,
yep.
You got any new ideas for trips?
Absolutely, Earthwatch. I'm going to go on one of those expeditions.
You like that,
I thought that was the greatest thing.
Which one would you do?
Well, this is my challenge. I don't know, out of the hundreds, I don't know which one I'm going to pick yet. So I'm going to have to take a little bit of time, look at the catalog.
Good example of what you said before. I mean, you found out about this stuff, really, on the web.
Oh,
you might not
great.
Otherwise have discovered this stuff.
It's a little more roughing it than I think my girlfriend would,
yeah.
would go for.
No room service.
No. But you know what you said about being able to find hotel rooms on the web? I thought that was really fascinating. I have gotten stuck in some terrible hotel rooms on business. There's this Howard Johnson's on 34th Street in New York. the scariest place. If I had been able to see the roaches on the web, I probably wouldn't have gone there.
All right, let me tell you one hotel story which really shows the value of using the web to book travel. I was in New York working. Turned out I had to spend an extra day there. Didn't have a hotel room. Walked into a hotel on 57th Street. Walked up to the counter there and said, can I have a room tonight? They said, we're fully booked, sorry. I went back to my office, took my laptop, logged onto the internet, booked that very hotel using a travel service, walked back into the hotel lobby, checked in, and the guy said, here's your room.
Unbelievable.
So the net is more real than real, right?
Amazing.
You should be doing some of your traveling on the net. We'll see you here next week again at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the internet. Connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor. Videotapes of the Internet Cafe are available for $24.95 each. To order your copy, call 1-800-916-PCTV. We'll help you stay on top of the rapidly changing world of computers and personal technology. Call today for your copy of this episode of the Internet Cafe or any of our other award-winning programs. When ordering, please ask for tapes by show number and title. That's 1-800-916-PCTV.